Hello friends, welcome to Prostha Hub, myself Dr. Jolsna, and this is the second session of Recent Advances in Implant Prosthodontics. So in our previous session we have covered the advances in diagnostic imaging and the advances in implant design under macrogeometry. So in this session we will be discussing the microgeometry, the advances in surface modifications and materials. Before beginning into the topic, I request everyone to please do like and share my videos if you are finding them useful. And if you are new to this channel, please do subscribe and show your support. And if you have any queries or suggestions or any topic that needs to be discussed, do comment below the video or you can mail me at this mail ID. So let's start. Now let's see the advances in implant design under microgeometry. So the microgeometry of the implant mainly deals with the surface modifications or surface characterizations. So there are a lot of studies going on in order to modify the surface of the implant to enhance osseointegration as well as the bone response. Basically, there is additive surface characterization where the surface of the implant is roughened by adding materials onto the surface. So this can be by variety of methods like ion deposition, simple precipitation, plasma spray, etc. And similarly, in subtractive surface characterization, micro indentations are made on the surface by methods like acid etching, alkaline etching, sandblasting, grid blasting, etc. And we can use a combination of additive as well as subtractive. And similarly, biologically active drugs also can be incorporated onto the surface of the implant to enhance osseointegration and the quality of the implant. Now let's see some of the additive surface characterizations. The first one, hydroxyapatite coating. So this hydroxyapatite coating was introduced by Dr. D. Groot, and the main advantage of hydroxyapatite coating was that it forms a very strong chemical bond with the bone due to the presence of free calcium and phosphate, and that resulted in excellent osseointegration. And also there is partial dissolution of hydroxyapatite, which makes the surrounding fluid rich in calcium as well as phosphate ions, and that triggers cellular differentiation as well as bone formation. Coming to the disadvantages, that is induction of impurities due to the thermal decomposition that happens during processing, which affected the long-term clinical fixation of the implant, and also dissolution of hydroxyapatite at the lower pH. And because the bond of the hydroxyapatite is very strong with that of the bone, there happened delamination of the coating from the implant surface. So these were the various disadvantages of hydroxyapatite coating. And these are the methods by which the hydroxyapatite is incorporated onto the surface, that is the biplasma spraying, sol gel method, ion sputtering method, pulsed laser deposition, ion beam assisted deposition, electrophoretic coating and dip coating. If you want to know in detail about these techniques, do comment below the video. Next one is TCP or tricalcium phosphate coating. So the main difference from hydroxyapatite coating is that here coating is not continuous but it is dispersed, and because of the dispersed coating there is no concern of delamination from the implant surface. And the tricalcium phosphate particles also enhance osseointegration during the healing phase. And the main method of TCP coating is by simple precipitation. Coming to zirconia coating, which consists of zirconium dioxide, titanium dioxide and phosphorus pentoxide. So the zirconia is coated and fired in a furnace on a titanium core in a way similar to that of the ceramic coated on the metal copings in case of metal ceramic crown. So the zirconia coating undergoes a transitional phase which is called as a bioactive glass, and this bioactive glass is mainly the microcrystalline zirconium titanate. And because of this transitional phase, there is improved proliferation and expression of osteocalcin as well as bone sialoprotein. Even zirconia is used to fabricate the implant instead of titanium because of its improved characteristics. Finally, sintered titanium bead coating. So here Endopore implant is a Canadian implant that's fabricated by this technique, that is small millimeter size beads of titanium are sintered onto the surface of the titanium core, and it showed that it promoted bone growth into the spaces between these beads, and that enhanced osseointegration. But the main disadvantage of this technique was that there was bacterial accumulation under these beads. That is, once the bacteria enters into the coating, they can freely colonize all the way up to the apex of the implant. And because of this reason, these implants failed. So we have discussed about four different coatings, that is hydroxyapatite, tricalcium phosphate coating, zirconia coating, and the sintered titanium bead coating. So basically, the implant surface modification technique can be categorized into two major classes. That is, one is biological and the other one mechanical, physical, or chemical, which is again subclassified into additive methods as well as subtractive methods. So additive method include plasma spraying, hydroxyapatite, calcium phosphate and other coatings, oxidation, ion deposition, etc. Whereas subtractive method consists of sandblasting, grit blasting, acid alkaline etching, electroplating, mechanical polishing, laser microfeaturing, etc. And finally, the biological method that includes incorporation of polypeptide growth factors and differentiation factors, the cytokines, calcium phosphate, etc. Now let's discuss some of the additive methods. So here is plasma spraying, where you heat the material to very high temperatures, where it gets transformed to its plasma state, and then you spray it onto the surface of the implant. For example, hydroxyapatite and titanium can be coated onto the implant surface by this method. So while coating with a highly reactive material that is in its plasma state, it gives you excellent bond strength. And another advantage is that there is no damage to the substrate surface. And in order to avoid the plasma material from reacting with the atmosphere, this procedure is usually carried out in a controlled chamber, as you can see in the picture. And this is in the presence of inert argon gas. And the material is coated to a thickness of about 50 to 100 microns. So this is the plasma gas. It is sprayed and the powder is injected and the coating is made on the implant surface. Now, during this process, the surface area of the implant increases by around 600%. So this in turn enhances osteogenesis. So this is about plasma spraying. Next is anodization, which is an electrochemical process to increase the surface roughness as well as thickness of the titanium oxide layer. So by anodization, we are modifying the crystalline nature of the titanium oxide layer. So basically, we are placing the implant, titanium implant, as anodes in electrolytic solution of phosphoric acid and trisodium phosphate, and current is passed. So this will result in growth of native titanium oxide layer on the surface that grows from 5 nanometer thickness to 10,000 nanometer thickness, and also it results in a porous surface topography, and all these will improve the osteoblastic attachment, the proliferation, as well as bone response. Next one is direct metal laser sintering, or DMLS technology, which is one of the latest technology that is used in dentistry, where you fabricate a complex 3D object from powder based material, and it is based on a computer designed model. So titanium implants can also be fabricated by this technique, and the implants will be with an inherent porous surface. And here the implant is built layer by layer using powdered titanium alloy and also a radiant heater and a computer controlled laser. That is, the machine adds a layer of the titanium alloy powder and then sinters them with the laser. The most important advantage of this technique is that yield strength and the elastic modulus of the implant is same as that of the bone. Now let's discuss some of the subtractive characterization methods. So in additive characterization, we said that we are adding a material onto the surface of the implant and there is always a chance of delamination. So subtractive characterization methods were used, which produce micro rough indentation on the implant surface that enhance the bone response. So let's see them. The first one is acid etching, where you immerse the implant in acidic solution, that is usually a mixture of concentrated hydrochloric and sulfuric acid that is heated above 100 degrees Celsius, which is called as dual acid etching. And this creates micro pits on the surface of the implant ranging from 0.5 to 2 micrometer in diameter. And because of these micro rough surface, it promoted adhesion of osteogenic cells onto the surface. and the quality of the surface roughness were dependent on the factors like concentration of acid, etching duration and temperature of the acid. And instead of acid, we can also use lasers like neodymium YAG in order to etch the implant surface. So here you can see the scanning electron microscopic image of an etched titanium surface. Similarly, there is alkaline etching, and the most common alkali used is caustic soda or sodium hydroxide. And when you etch the titanium implant in a boiling alkali solution, it creates irregular surface with nanoscale pits, as you can see in the picture, and this enhances the bone response. Next method is sandblasting, where you blast the implant surface with alumina particles of size ranging from 150 to 350 microns, and this improves adhesion, proliferation and differentiation of osteoblast by the formation of a mechanical bond by increasing the surface roughness as well as the surface area. And similarly, there is grit blasting, where you use large size particles to create large size irregularities, and the other particles that can be used for blasting are titanium dioxide, zirconia dioxide, hydroxyapatite, etc. And usually blasting is always followed by acid etching in order to remove the remaining or residual blasting particles which may inhibit osseointegration. So in titanium blasting, as I have already said, 25 micron titanium dioxide particles were used to blast the surface, and such implants were called as the Tioblast implants, commercially fabricated by the AstraTech company. And the Tioblast implants showed the surface topography with micro pits of 1 to 1.2 micrometer size, and these implants were etched with hydrofluoric acid in order to remove the residual blasting particles. Next one is laser lithography or laser peening, where you use high intensity nanosecond pulses of laser beams to create the surface irregularities. And the characteristic feature of this technique is that the scanning electron microscopic image of such laser peen titanium surface shows a honeycomb pattern with small pores, as you can see in the figure. And another advantage is that this technique introduces compressive stresses onto the implant structure, which improves strength of the implant. So now we have discussed about the different subtractive modification techniques like acid etching, alkali etching, sandblasting, grit blasting, titanium blasting and laser lithography. And coming to combination techniques, where you combine one or two techniques together, like in case of acid etching and anodization. So in case of anodized acid etched implants, the bone to implant contact was reported to be high, and this is through mechanical interlocking through the bone growth in the surface irregularities, as well as through the biochemical bonding by the modification that you create in the chemical composition of the titanium oxide layer by anodization. And the next procedure is the combination of sandblasting and acid etching. We have already discussed, this is to remove the residual blasting particles. And then comes the acid etching along with collagen coating, where you use type 1 collagen, and the collagen coating increases tissue vascularization and also it decreases the inflammatory response as well as the osteoclastic activity. Thus it promotes the initial cell attachment. This is about acid etching and collagen coating. And then comes acid etching along with biomimetic coatings, where you use polypeptide growth factors, differentiation factors and cytokines, and all these will stimulate the deposition of cell on the implant surface that has got the capacity of regenerating the desired tissue. So these are some of the combination techniques in order to further enhance the surface qualities. Now coming to the incorporation of biologically active drugs. So first one is bisphosphonates, which is reported to improve the implant osseointegration. Similarly, simvastatin, which induces the expression of factors like BMP and mRNA that promotes bone formation and increases the bone mineral density. And gentamicin, along with a layer of hydroxyapatite coating, act as a local prophylactic agent along with the systemic antibiotics in dental implant surgery. Next is the different implant materials. As you can see in the given table, there is a lot of advancement that has happened in the use of different materials to fabricate implant. So under metals, titanium, titanium alloys, stainless steel, cobalt chromium alloy, gold alloys, and even tantalum was used to fabricate the implant. Whereas under ceramics, the advancement started with alumina and reaching up to zirconia toughened alumina. And under polymers, starting from polymethyl methacrylate and reaching up to polyether ether ketone or the PEEK implants. So zirconia is a ceramic material that is used to fabricate the entire implant or even can be used as a coating on the implant surface, which we have already discussed. So the zirconia implants have got the advantages of biocompatibility or bioinertness. It has got high aesthetics, high resistance to corrosion, flexion and fracture, and contact with bone and soft tissue is similar to that observed in the titanium implants. And the PEEK implants, that is polyether ether ketones, have got good strength, fracture resistance and bioinertness, and it also promotes human osteoblastic cell growth. But it has got the disadvantages like faintly radio opaque, that means it is difficult for the post-op evaluation as it is faintly radio opaque, and the length and diameter range is also restricted in case of PEEK implants. Next is the advancement in implant abutments, which we will be discussing in our coming session. So thank you all for watching my video. Please do like, share my videos if you are finding them useful, and also if you are new to this channel, please do subscribe and show your support. If you have any queries or suggestions or any topic that needs to be discussed, you can comment below the video or you can directly mail me at this mail ID. So thank you all once again, and we'll meet in our next session.